from 1980, that's Paul McCartney with Coming Up. And coming up next is a gentleman who's written a second volume of his series of books, Paul McCartney After the Beatles, A Musical Appreciation. And I'd like to welcome back the author, Adrian Allen, to AJ on your radio. Hi, Adrian.
Hi, nice to join you again.
Delightful to have you back. As you heard, played Coming Up to come into the interview, and it's one of the songs you talk about in your book.
That's right, yeah. And I think with Coming Up, it was really his return to being a solo artist. It was his first single after quitting Wings, really, in 1980. And it was a funk song, and it was one of a funk-inspired song. And John Lennon actually said it was one of his best songs at the time. So it inspired John Lennon, apparently, to start making music again as well.
Right.
So, yeah, it's an interesting song. He did two very different versions. There's a live version at Glasgow as well.
Mm-hmm.
And the version on the album McCartney 2 was recorded in his studio. And I think some of it was recorded up in his Mull of Kintyre studio as well.
And it came on the tail end of the 70s boom of the disco scene.
Yeah, I think really, listening to it, it's more got more influence of funk than disco, but there is a crossover between the two. And when I listened to it, I could see links to one of the Average White Band's biggest hits. And as we know, Hamish Stewart, the members of Average White Band, went on to join McCartney's touring band in the late 80s. So I have a theory that it was maybe influenced by listening to a particular hit by the Average White Band, their biggest song.
Of course, McCartney throughout his careers encompassed various types of music, disco, ballads, even classical.
Yep, he has. He's one of the most eclectic composers you can think of. And after the Beatles, he's even written a few sort of Latin or South American influence pieces as well, which was something he really didn't do in the Beatles. So his career has spread out even a bit further as well. And he's done a few electronica projects as well, which he's done under the name of The Fireman with another producer.
Obviously, he must have felt more freedom being a solo artist.
Yeah, I mean, he had more room to experiment and do his own thing. I mean, some people have argued that the quality control was taken off a little bit when he left the Beatles because there was nobody's really been strong enough to stand up to him and give an honest opinion about some of his weaker songs.
Yeah.
And although he's had a great solo career, don't think anybody can say that many of his albums, maybe apart from Band on the Run, have got the same consistency off the Beatles' last run of albums from Rubber Soul onwards, where almost every song is a classic. But on every McCartney album, there are interesting and good songs. Band on the Run is probably the most consistent, where you listen from beginning to end and can say nearly every song on there is of a really high standard.
And with the songs you've chosen for this second volume of your works, you've went for lesser known McCartney songs like Teddy Boy and Eat at Home.
Well, these are songs that the McCartney fans will know because they're on the albums.
Mm-hmm.
I've gone for some even more obscure ones than that as well. There's actually a couple of songs I wasn't even aware of until they were pointed out. I did ask for some songs fans to give me some suggestions. Somebody said an instrumental called Squid, which was recorded sometime in the 80s. I must admit I've not heard that one before, but that's quite an interesting track. And there's another one which is called Why So Blue, which was done in about 2007, and that's actually, I think, stronger than a lot of the songs that made it onto the album. So when you start looking into McCartney's entire catalogue, you do find some gems there which really should have been more recognised and more noticed.
Mm-hmm. As you say, there are gems that are maybe now just getting noticed, like Daytime, Nighttime Suffering.
Yeah, and that's one song I've not done in either book, but right. If I ever do a volume 3, I might do it. And that song apparently was written as a challenge over the weekend. Wings needed an extra song to put on the reverse of Goodnight Tonight as a single.
Mm-hmm.
And they all said, we haven't got a song, so we challenge each other to write a song over the weekend. Acid Wings came up with their best efforts, but of course McCartney's daytime now time suffering blew all the other competition out of the water, and it became a double A side. So he apparently, according to Steve Holly, the drummer in Wings at the time, Paul McCartney wrote that as a challenge just over a weekend.
Right. Ah, I actually didn't know it was written as a challenge.
Yeah.
And that's for our next track. It's a track that's maybe became better known in recent years, but it started out as the B-side of Helen Wheels, and that's Sally G.
Somewhere to the south of New York City lies the friendly state of Tennessee. Down in Nashville town I met a pretty, who made a pretty big fool out of me. And they call her Sally, Sally G. Why do you wanna do the things you do to me? You're my Sally, Sally G. Part that was the heart of me, Sally G. The nightlife took me down to Prince's Alley, where Sally sang a song behind the bar. I ran my eyes across her as she sang a tangled mind. I used to love to hear her sweet guitar. And they called her Sally, Sally G. Why do you wanna do the things you do to me? You're my Sally, Sally G. You took the part that was the heart of me, Sally G. Took off, things began to look up. Me and her were going strong. Then she started lying. I could see our love was dying. I heard a voice say, move along. If she ever really understood, I never thought to ask her what the letter G stood for, but I know for sure it wasn't good. And they called her Sally, Sally G. Why do you wanna do the things you do to me? You're my part of me, Sally G. Take it, chaps. Sally G.
Yeah, Sally G.
That was a track that started out as the B-side of the 1973 single Helen Wheels by Wings, and that's Sally G. And I've got the man here to tell us all about it, Adrian Allen.
Well, apparently Sally G was written after a trip to Princess Alley, which is a part of Nashville, town centre, and Paul McCartney was there, and he was witnessed by Jeff Britton, who was a drummer at the time in Wings. And I actually have an interview with Jeff Britton in my book, and he told me that after this trip to Princess Alley, Paul McCartney was so inspired by the music and all the country styles and influences, he just woke up the next morning and presented this song to the band, which he'd just seemingly written in a matter of hours at the piano in Princess Alley, and also on the guitar when he'd returned to Nashville. He presented it to the band, so it's amazing how quickly he can come up with these songs.
You're saying at the speed he can come up with song. It's rumoured that he wrote Live and Let Die in 18 minutes.
Yes, I think I've heard that one as well. But, I mean, it's a bit misleading to talk sometimes about how fast he wrote it, because you've got to think about the production as well on these songs, which is so amazing. Sally G, he employed some of the best session musicians of the country style in the whole of the Nashville area, and that song has got some great violin parts, and it's got a pedal steel guitar, so it's all these little licks and riffs which give it its signature style. But it was, of course, McCartney who came up with the original song, but the production on that track is superb as well.
And if I recall correctly, the track, although being the B-side of the single, actually reached the USA country charts.
Yes, that's right. It was originally released, and then they flipped it over and made Sally G the A-side to give it another run to see if it could go up the charts again. So there's a rare version of it where you can find Sally G actually listed as the A-side. But it's one of, I think that track Sally G is forgotten about nowadays, but it's still remembered in some country circles.
I would assume that was around about the time he also recorded the instrumental Walking in the Park with Eloise.
That's right. That's the song that his father wrote, and it was recorded, again, with the same group of session musicians from the Nashville scene. They actually even did a jingle for an advert for Mother's Pride Bread, which is an interesting one, called Proud Mum, and that was never released. And I asked Jeff Britton about it, and you can find us on bootlegs. So there's this really interesting instrumental called Proud Mum for the Mother's Pride Bread, but it was never released because there was some sort of a bread strike or something like that at the time in 1974. So that's an interesting one. So they did record a few interesting tracks there in Nashville, and they're really enhanced by these great musicians who were working with at the time.
Well, Adrian, we'll take another little break there, but instead of me picking all the tracks and taking away the privilege from you, is it a track of McCartney's that you'd like to hear?
Yeah, I think that people should really listen to this song, which is called Why So Blue, which I really think is a neglected masterpiece. And it was written, I think, about 2007. It should have gone on the Memory Almost Full album, but it became relegated to a B-side. But it's an outstanding song. It's got all these different twists and turns. And I think it's got something like six changes of key signature for the musicians to listen out for.
Well, here we are from 2007. This is Paul McCartney, Why So Blue.
Staring from a cardboard castle down and out, one of life's young students finds out what it's all about. Paper flutters, angry taxi drivers shout. From the pages of a paper, candles shine on a perfect table laid for two who love to dine. They suggest a highly recommended wine. Once again, the same old line. Why so sad? Carriage horses stand in single file. Someone at a crowded bus stop wears a friendly smile, touching nerves that no one's heard from in a while. Papers from the same old file. Why so sad?
From 2007, a track picked by my guest Adrian Allen. That's Paul McCartney's Why So Blue. Adrian, would you like to tell people how they can get a hold of this great book, the second volume of your works?
Yeah, well, both volumes are available. I've got my own website now, which is called paulmccartneyafterthebeatles.com. And rather than just being a place to sell books, it's also got lots of articles about some of these songs. And I really take a more holistic approach there, where I look at different themes within McCartney's music from the 70s onwards. Mm-hmm. So rather than just being a place to buy the books, you might be interested to read some of the articles I've put up there as well, mm-hmm. and some of the discussions we've had.
Amongst the songs you do talk about in this volume two, that obviously the ones we've mentioned, but also ones that have now became concert favourites, like Mrs. Vanderbilt, Call Me Back Again, and obviously the bigger hits like Let Him In and Silly Love Songs. So it's a wide-ranging discussion on McCartney's music. But a track I'd like to go out with is from, if memory serves me right, 1979, and the last major hit from Wings, Goodnight Tonight.
That's right, and it's an interesting track because it's a fusion, really, of disco and Latin elements. And I think at the time, the Latin beat you can hear was actually triggered by a late 1970s drum machine, and they used to actually take a pretend robot on stage in the late 70s, and they used to trigger this drum machine and pretend that it was a robot starting the music. So the Latin beat's influenced by that, but it's also got it's an interesting disco sort of beat overlaid in it, and it's got really great sort of Latin-style guitar solo, which is played by Lawrence Juber as well. A lot of people remember that guitar solo in the middle of the track.
The longer guitar solo is on the 12-inch version rather than the 7-inch vinyl version, but yeah, it's a great track. Well, Adrian, I'd like to thank you for joining us here again on AJ on your radio. I wish you every success with Paul McCartney After the Beatles, A Musical Appreciation Volume 2. And for those that haven't read Volume 1 yet, I hope they do so. Two interesting books, because you actually delve into the formation of the songs, not just chart statistics of the songs, which most books do.
Yeah, that's right. That's what my particular interest in is. And I did learn a lot researching it myself, so I learned a lot. I think other people will as well, reading them.
Yeah. Well, Adrian, thank you very much. Thank you very much.